Hi, good evening, everybody. Welcome to Wilton Library. I'm Michael Bellicosa. I'm the head of adult programming here at the library. I'm also the curator of the Brubeck collection, which is one of the most significant and largest jazz archives in the world. And we have it here in Wilton Library. Yeah. And I love showing off some of the amazing things we have in the collection. We've got thousands of photos, we've got hundreds of audio recordings, we've got dozens and dozens of DVD concert recordings that can be watched and listened to. Just if you wanna have a visit, we do it by appointment generally only, and just give me a call, I'm pretty flexible, and we'll have you over for a visit, show you the highlights, and you can stay as long as you like. So first, please turn off your cell phones and devices. We're recording this. We want to try to get a decent recording out of it. And then a short program note. This is the second of four programs on the absolutely amazing year in jazz history, 1959. And we'll be covering the most significant albums in jazz, all recorded and released within 12 months of each other. On May 22, we'll cover Coltrane's Giant Steps. And the capstone presentation will be on June 18th, which pulls it all together. And that is on the 18th. We moved it up a day from the initial publicity because the 19th is Juneteenth this year. So we'll see you on May 22 and June 18. You have to sign up for the sessions individually. But tonight we're featuring Dave Brubeck's Time Out, certainly one of the most iconic jazz albums of all time. And we're fortunate to have with us my friend Gil Harel, a brilliant musicologist and educator who has given us so many fantastic programs over the last several years. And Gil has a PhD from Brandeis University, and he's a musicologist and composer whose interests include styles ranging from Western art music to contemporary musical theater. Previously served on the faculty at CUNY Baruch College, where he was awarded the prestigious Presidential Excellence Award for Distinguished Teaching. And currently, he's a full professor of music at Connecticut State Naugatuck Valley, where he has been presented with the AFT Merit Award for Exemplary Service to the College for six consecutive years. In 2020, he was honored with the coveted Connecticut Board of Regents Teaching Award. And at Naugatuck Valley, Dr. Harel conducts the college chorale, a cappella ensemble. He teaches music history and music theory, and he serves as musical director of theater productions. So please join me in welcoming back to the Brubeck Room, live and in person, Dr. Gil Harel.
Tremendous. Good evening, friends. I want to start with an anecdote. When I was in graduate school, we were trained as young budding musicologists that if we were to pursue careers in academia, we were to become pedagogues and scholars, we should avoid using superlative language when we describe music. Don't say that so-and-so is the greatest or that this piece is the best. Try to avoid that sort of thing because it smacks too much of editorialism. But I would suggest to you that it would be difficult to discuss Dave Brubeck's Time Out without using superlative language. There's plenty of data that bears this out. For example, many of you know that Time Out is the first jazz album to crest the coveted 1 million sales spot. That's impressive. We know that Time Out features probably the most iconic Dave Brubeck chart of all time. And in fact, I was telling Michael before the program, we could have had an entire program just about everyone's favorite song in 5/4, Take Five. Take Five, by the way, became an international sensation, charting in the top 10 of essentially hit parades all over the world. And it remains to this day, I think, one of the most instantly recognizable tunes in the jazz canon. It's that famous vamp. It's that drum groove that Joe Morello came up with. We're going to listen to the antecedent to that iconic groove from those recording sessions where they were sort of, you might say, to borrow a phrase from Gen Z, messing around with a vamp, with a pattern, essentially, upon which Paul Desmond would eventually create that famous melody. And it all goes together so silkily, so perfectly, that it is a head scratcher that the band thought that this tune would probably be a footnote in their history. that this would not be a big seller, but rather just another chart that maybe would do okay, but it wouldn't become the sensation that it eventually became. Of course, there's so much to say about Time Out, but before we do that, as we did in our previous program on Miles Davis, I want to talk about the road to Time Out, the road to 1959, and the trajectory that brought the Brubeck Quartet to this seminal album, which, as Michael mentioned in his opening comments, is one of several remarkable albums. We talked about Miles Davis's Kind of Blue in our last program, and I'm going to reference a few things about that program when I go over to the piano in just a little while. First, you might notice on the screen, here's a one of many photos that the Brubeck Archive possesses here. These are photos that you can't find with a Google search. One of the very cool things about being here in the Brubeck Room at the Wilton Library is it reminds us of the incredible advantages conferred upon not just scholars and those who are intent on doing research on Brubeck and his music, but any community member. You know, if you can check in with Michael and comb through these, there's way too many pictures for me to possibly share them all with you here. These are just some, and the ones that I'm going to share mostly are from the famous State Department-sponsored trip of the Jazz Ambassadors, where the Brubeck Quartet went over to mostly Eastern Europe, Eurasia, if you will, in 1958. So that immediately preceded the creation of Time Out, and the two are irrevocably intertwined for reasons we're going to discuss. But to give you a brief background, I think Dave Brubeck is probably no stranger to the folks in this room, but in case you're of a neophyte bent, let's do a little bit of a quick background about Maestro Brubeck. Born 1920, Concord, California. You know, George Lucas, who's also a Northern California guy, I think Clint Eastwood was also part of this documentary. They said that there's something special about Northern Californians. There's just something in the water up there. And they're different from Southern Californians, or New Yorkers, for example. And I think that maybe there's something to it. One thing you could easily glean when you watch media interviews, for example, with Dave Brubeck, especially as he aged and became an elder statesman, not just for the American music community, but for jazz in particular, we get the impression that he's an almost impossibly affable guy. He just smiles so easily. It all seems so genuine. It seems so light and breezy to him. But what comes across more than anything is the passion. And that passion never dimmed. You see him playing. We're going to watch a clip from a recording that was done in 2007. So Dave's approaching his 90th birthday, and there he is playing on take five. And the solo is so unusual, so unique, and it's breathtaking. It's so expressive. It's different, certainly, than what you get on the 1959 record. So I'm excited that we get to traverse half a century of Dave Brubeck, essentially, tonight, even just through the prism of this one album and that one song. So he grows up in Northern California. Some of you may not know this, but he met Iola Whitlock at the time. They got married when they were fairly young. I think Iola was 19. I'm looking over at Chris Brubeck here because he probably would remember better than me, but they were quite 1942, I think. So shortly after their marriage, Dave is shipped off to the European theater. He's in Patton's army, and they're going through France, through Germany. In fact, Dave wrote a tune about crossing the Rhine. I think it's called We Cross the Rhine. And there he is, and the story goes that a Red Cross truck pulls up one day, and it's a day before they're supposed to engage in some kind of combat. And off the side of the truck comes a stage, and there's a piano, and says, anybody here play piano? And of course, Dave, whose mother was a concert pianist, or taught piano, and studied concert repertoire, I should say, he had plenty of piano, and from the age of six, he wanted to be a jazz musician. And apparently, his mom got on board after they were driving in the car, and they heard Art Tatum on the radio, and she said, okay, now I see it. I see why you want to study this kind of music. So Dave says, oh, I play piano. So young Dave Brubeck, who's in his early 20s, gets up and plays, and the story goes, as Dave later told it, that as they're preparing for combat, essentially, the next day, and remember, this is in the time of the Battle of the Bulge. This is serious, high-stakes thing going on here. He's not in some cushy unit that's, counting inventory or something like that. And so he plays so well that the next day, as they're calling out roll for who's going to go into combat, his name is called, and with two other guys, he was told that they're going to be staying behind. And the story goes that one of the colonels who was involved in staffing the battle after he heard Dave Brubeck play, said, not this guy, don't send him into battle. We gotta make sure that he's around. I love that story. And of course, Dave, even though there's a lot of gravitas and weight to the story, he tells it with that signature smile, that signature warmth. And you can even see it in this photo, and we'll look at more photos from that trip in 1958. All right, let's continue on. Dave comes back from Europe in 1946, I believe early 1946. So he'd been there for quite a while. And during his time in Europe, he connected with Darius Milhaud. And the promise was that after the war, through the GI Bill, he was going to go to Mills College and study with the rest of the Mills boys, as Milhaud called them, would later call them. He would study with this celebrated French composer. Milhaud was a very interesting figure. Iola described him as not only a brilliant musician, but just a very good man, a nice guy. And one of the most salient things about Milhaud, obviously he had been weaned on French Impressionism, Ravel, Debussy, Satie, but he loved jazz. We get the impression, not only listening to Milhaud's music, but also reading about him, that this was somebody who really admired jazz musicians. And supposedly, as Dave would later relate in interviews, Milhaud claimed to be jealous of Dave's ability to play jazz. And he always encouraged him not to try to incorporate sort of traditional Western European styles, but to do his own thing. And that's one of the things you might say is so steadfast throughout the Brubeck catalog, is that Dave just has this voice, and it comes through. And he would reject terms like, for example, cool jazz, which was a term bandied about in the 1950s, used to describe West Coast jazz musicians, someone like Chet Baker or Cal Chater, Jerry Mulligan, those names come to mind. And Dave always rejected that. And there's a funny clip of Dave talking about the designation of a cool jazz musician. He says, I could show you recordings from the 1950s where we're playing stuff so hot it's steaming. And by the way, this is from an interview that he gave. He must have been, again, close to 90 years old when he gave it. And you just see the boyish enthusiasm on the youngest 90-year-old you ever saw in your life. It's inspiring, really, because I think, you know, the old expression, if you love what you do, you never work a day in your life. And you could just keep doing it and doing it. And that's kind of what we get with Dave Brubeck. It's a really, you can only imagine how the rest of the world, if we had a scintilla of that kind of fulfillment, I think it would be a much happier place. All right, we get to the 1950s. Dave is mostly playing with a trio at the time, and they're doing something which is rather pioneering. They're on what would later be called the college circuit. And they would play at, you know, a number of big universities, University of Michigan, for example. And it's in the later half of the 50s that the quartet forms. And this is the iconic quartet we're going to be listening to mostly this evening. So let's introduce the cast of characters, the dramatis personae, if you will. On the piano, drum roll please, Dave Brubeck, obviously. On the drums, and this is going to be critical, because when we talk about the anatomy of Time Out, the nuts and bolts of what goes into that album, you'll see that in any ensemble, you need a great rhythm section, right? But on this album in particular, I don't think it's the same successful album that it became without Joe Morello on drums. So you've got Joe Morello on drums, you've got Eugene Wright on bass. Eugene Wright, African-American, that would prove to be controversial in some venues, and Dave always went to bat for Gene Wright. Any promoters or club owners who said didn't want an integrated band, Dave basically told them, no thanks. And I'm putting it diplomatically there. That's probably not what he would have said. And then finally, the signature silky sound of Paul Desmond on the alto saxophone. Such a unique voice. And if you listen to the great saxophone players of that period, you really can pick out Paul Desmond's sound. I think for those of us who listen to a lot of jazz, there is something about it which is, it feels like it's floating. It has this ethereal, effortless quality to it. Very different, for example, from the rather stentorian sound that John Coltrane would conjure up. And we're going to talk about Coltrane in May, so we'll leave him for another day. The other thing that we get about Dave Brubeck, and this goes back to the earliest days, but it remains steadfast throughout his career, not only is he affable and warm and genuinely passionate, but he's got a great sense of humor. And we're going to talk about a couple of anecdotes that testify to that sense of humor. He was also a very humble man. Many of you know that Dave's face was put on Time magazine in the 1950s, and he was always very sheepish about that. And there's a story about Duke Ellington coming to his hotel room and showing him the cover of Time magazine and saying, hey, Dave, look, you made it. And Dave's response to Duke Ellington was, should have been you. So again, a testament to his humbleness and that lack of ego. And that remains, you know, as I said earlier, consistent throughout his career. All right, let's get to 1958. Jazz at this point was more or less a half a century old, and yet there were certain parts of the world where jazz was verboten. For example, in the Soviet Union. Soviet Union had taken a harsh stance against what they called formalism. Essentially what that meant, it's a sort of opaque term, it doesn't really mean anything, and if you, for example, were to study the career of Shostakovich, you would see that he came up against this branding, formalist. What did it mean? It was a term that they used basically to stigmatize music that they thought smacked of too much of a Western bent. For example, jazz. Jazz was a distinctly American creation, and as such, it stands to reason in the Soviet Union, they weren't going to be big fans. The Third Reich, the Nazis, obviously were not big fans of jazz. There's that infamous poster that shows the anthropomorphized ape with a Jewish star, you know, Star of David, playing a saxophone, and it says, Entartete Kunst, degenerate music or degenerate art. Kunst is art. And so in certain parts of the world, jazz had developed this sort of underground popularity, but it was not mainstream. It couldn't be mainstream because you could be beaten up by the Stasi, for example, in East Germany, if you were listening to it. And so the State Department, rather cannily, decided to export jazz to certain parts of the world where listeners could enjoy it in a more, again, this would be part of a state-sponsored function, but it would be one that I think most historians would agree there's a sort of a motive that the State Department has. On the one hand, yes, we're just exchanging culture, we're sharing great art, but on the other hand, we're sort of sticking it to those Soviets, right? We're sharing with them not just any kind of music, but a music that from their perspective is the most transgressive music you can imagine. Why? Because jazz is about freedom. And that's epitomized in the fact that one of the signature traits of jazz is improvisation. What distinguishes jazz from ragtime, for example? Sometimes people conflate them, right? They'll think of ragtime as a kind of version of jazz. It's an antecedent in some way, to be sure, but ragtime, generally speaking, does not encourage or ask for improvisation, so it's not really jazz. Jazz encourages performers to explore. And so when the State Department exported jazz overseas, they were sending a type of music that was antithetical to the ethos, to the Weltanschauung, if you will, of some of those states that were hosting these musicians. And so Dave and the rest of the quartet went over, again, mostly to Eastern Europe. They spent a couple of weeks in Poland, and the Polish were hugely supportive. They loved it. They couldn't outwardly express that during the concerts, right? If the authorities heard them raucously cheering, that would have been bad news. But nonetheless, all the anecdotal evidence suggests that they were very warmly received. And they went all over the place. This particular picture was taken on a tarmac in Baghdad. And I love this. You can see Dave with that signature smile on his face. Here's Dave perusing albums in a record store, also in Baghdad. Dave and Gene Wright. Love it. And look at the smiles once again. These guys are having fun. We can even imagine that when they were recording Time Out, even though they hit some bumps in the road, which we'll discuss, we can imagine the smiles. And we've got some audio we're going to listen to. All of this, by the way, courtesy of the Brubeck Archive with our amazing curator, Michael Bellicoso, over there. Let's hear it for him. I love this. Look at the focus and intensity and curiosity on Dave's face as he's watching Indian Carnatic music played on some sitar or some instrument like that. Here's Dave and Leonard Bernstein's conducting. Pretty cool. There's Lenny, Paul Desmond. Ah, wait a second. Where is he? All right, Chris. Yeah, this is in Tanglewood, right? Look at that. Dave, Iola, and the kids. We're gonna get a cameo from the kids, some of the kids at least, later today. And here we have them in the studio in 1959, and they're listening back at the time, which is, I love this, you know? This is great. Just think today, if you were going to go into a studio and record, and it's just audio, and yet, you know, Paul Desmond's wearing a suit here. That's great. And here's some sheet music. I think this is Kathy's waltz. Here it's spelled on the lead sheet with a C, the correct way, of course. On the album, it's spelled with a K. Funny story about that. All right. So what's the takeaway here from this amazing trip in 1958? Of course, for Dave, the curious seeker of knowledge who is so interested in all musical forms, remember he had grown up in a different idiom. His mother was playing more traditional Western European classical repertoire, and he knows that repertoire very well. Of course, he's going to fall in love with Art Tatum and jazz, and then he's going to study with Mio, where he's going to learn all sorts of styles. So the curiosity is there. And here he is on this State Department-sponsored trip, and he's all over the place. And we looked at pictures from Baghdad, but they're in Poland, I mentioned. They're in Pakistan, all over the place. And, of course, if you're a musician and you're in these exotic locations, can you imagine him sponging up sounds and getting inspired and thinking, how might that be integrated into some kind of jazz format? And I think the echo of Mio's teaching is present here, because even though he's going to absorb and assume some of these traits, these qualities that he's going to pick up abroad, the voice is always so unique and so rooted in jazz. And we're going to talk about that. That's significant. I would suggest to you that that's essential for the success of the album. Let's go ahead and go over to the piano, and we're going to discuss the first track that I've chosen for us, which is Blue Rondo a la Turque. All right. So the story goes that Dave is in Istanbul, in Turkey, and he's listening to these musicians, street musicians, buskers maybe, and they're playing, but they're not playing in the conventional time signatures that Western ears have acclimated to. Let me move to the piano, and I want to make sure for the recording, I'm talking into the microphone. So if you see me walking silently, it's not because I'm brooding or anything like that. I'm just waiting till I get to a microphone for the recording. All right. Hello. So do you remember when we talked about Miles Davis in the last program, and we talked about modal jazz, and we said that Davis had done this pioneering work in 1959 with modal jazz, and that was epitomized in the opening track on Kind of Blue, which is called So What, and it had these chords. And those chords kind of defied traditional chord nomenclature. It's not, remember, we talked about how in jazz, for example, in bebop, you might have very fast moving chord progressions, but each of those chords would have a very specific identity and certain notes that go with it. So for example, if you saw a D minor 7 symbol, which I'll use that because So What is kind of rooted in D, then you would have certain notes that were available to you. But playing in a modal style meant that you had more options. You could play different permutations of notes. And you might hear something like this. You hear these are weird they're chordal combinations, for example, meaning they defy traditional triadic architecture. It's not 1-3-5, it's something else. So if that was the pioneering essence of Kind of Blue, what is the pioneering essence of Time Out? And as the title of the album suggests, it's rhythm. When Dave came back from the trip, what he said, they asked him, what did you learn when you were abroad? And he had a very interesting answer. And it's an answer I think that really resonates when you think about it. He said, I learned that harmony is not universal, but rhythm is. What did he mean by that? I think what he meant is that if you go to certain parts of the world, certainly in the Middle East, for example, you might find music which is what we call heterophonic. What that means is you're not going to get chord progressions. What you get, you might get drone tones. You get that in Indian Carnatic music, in raga. You get drone tones, things like that, where instead of having fixed chord progressions of various harmonies, you have something that's maybe more fixed, or maybe you have some sort of microtonal system where the octave is divided differently. And all that is not universal, because it depends where you are. But almost every musical style in the world somehow can be counted. And therein lies the rub. In the Western world, we have a very limited palette of what we might think of as patterns of rhythmic organization, or what we call time signatures. Most Western music is in 4/4 time. In fact, it's so overwhelmingly common that we actually call it common time. You have a fair amount of music also written in 3/4. But outside of that, what do you have, for example, in the canon of Western art music? And the answer is not much. Look at the Bach catalog, for example, the Bach Werkeverzeichnis, the BWV catalog, which was organized by a musicologist named Wolfgang Schmieder, nice Irish guy. Wolfgang Schmieder. You got over 1,100 pieces in that catalog. Guess how many of them are in 5/4 or 9/8? Zero. It doesn't exist. You might get something exotic like in the Well-Tempered Clavier. I think in book two, the F major preludes in 6/16, but that's not as complex as it sounds. It's basically three. What you get in Time Out is explorations of time signatures. So again, keeping with our theme of exploring 1959 and why it was such a remarkable year, let's think about innovation. If the innovation in Kind of Blue has to do with exploring modal jazz, then the innovation in 1959 with Time Out has to do with exploring rhythm and organization of rhythm, metric patterns, which we call time signatures. So if you look at Bach, Mozart, Beethoven, there's really nothing. They're not writing in 5/4. They're not writing in 11/8. They're not writing in 7/4. The quirkiest thing you can get is in Beethoven Opus 111, his 32nd and final piano sonata, in the middle of the second movement, it goes into 12/32 time. And it's a nightmare to read. You look at it and you think, why did he do this? He's like a sadist? But if you boil it down, it really, you just feel it as a very broad three. It's just a broad three. That's a remarkable piece, by the way. If you don't know Opus 111, second movement, it's wild. Anyway, what you get in Time Out is an entire album which is primarily flavored with, not exclusively, but flavored with odd time signatures. Let's start with Blue Rondo. The pattern here. What was that? All right, so we got 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. So it's not a fixed 2, 2, 2, 3 all the way through. It's three bars of 2, 2, 2, 3, and then in the fourth bar, three groupings of three. And that three groupings of three is the more conventional way to see 9/8. But when Dave was in Istanbul, what did he hear on the streets? And supposedly when he asked the musicians, he said, what is that? What are you playing there? And one of the musicians said, for us, this is what the blues is for you. So it's fairly common organization of beats, I guess you would say. So the official time signature is 9/8. But it's not a conventional 9/8. It's 2 + 2 + 2 + 3. And then in the fourth, every fourth bar, 3 + 3 + 3. I have a challenge for you. Who wants to try to clap this with me? I'm going to play it slowly. We'll go at this tempo. Pretty good. All right. Not bad, everybody. All right. Rather than play it here on the piano, I'm going to fast forward from 1959 to 2009, where Dave was selected as an honoree at the Kettering Center, one of the most prestigious distinctions that you can get as an American contributor to the artistic fabric of our society. And there was Dave. Again, 2009 means he's close to his 90th birthday, and he's the youngest 90-year-old you ever saw. Let's go ahead and watch it. I've got a special surprise. Surprise for some, not a surprise for everybody.
Some of us may be familiar with this event.
All right. So here we are at the Kennedy Center. We're honoring Dave Brubeck. There's Michelle Obama. There's the boss, Bruce Springsteen. There's Mel Brooks. Pretty good class to be in. And here we go.
Thank you. ladies and gentlemen, the four sons of Dave Brubeck.
Brooks is digging it.
All right, so many things to love about this, right? But I think for many of us, we probably don't have to be expert lip readers to see what Dave says when the sort of the curtain is revealed. So I was just talking to Maestro Chris Brubeck, who happens to be with us this evening, and I asked him about this event, and he informed me that Dave had requested that the sons be there to play at the event, and the event organizer said, no, we can't accommodate. And it was all, you know, kept under wraps. So they were, you know, kind of squirreled away in a hotel trying to get to rehearsal. Because this is, you know, pretty intricate thing to weave together, right? You could probably hear one of the signature elements of Blue Rondo besides that rhythm that we talked about is how it seamlessly melds into like a laid-back 4-4 swing. This was a genuine surprise, and I love when the camera pans to Dave and you see the genuine surprise, and he says, son of a... What a thing to say when they reveal your son's on stage and you're sitting next to your wife of 70 years. You can't make this stuff up. What a story, right? All right. So that's a little bit about Blue Rondo. We're going to move on from Blue Rondo, but I have one more story to tell you. In the 90s, I think it was 94, Dave was at some White House function and he met Bill Clinton. And Bill Clinton says, you know, I'm a huge fan of yours. And Dave says, oh, another politician. Yeah, right. I'm sure you are. And he said, and Clinton says, no, you don't understand. You know, Time Out, I love that album. I love that album. I don't do a good Clinton, but anyway. So Dave puts some statistics, says, oh yeah, what's your favorite tune? And Clinton says, oh, it's Blue Rondo a la Turk. Okay, all right. Dave says, hum the bridge. And Clinton, to his credit, goes, dun, 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 dun. So I love that story. It's, you could really feel the humor in Dave's music and in Dave's personality. We'll get more humor a little bit later on in the program if we have time. And for those who are wondering, you're probably thinking, Gil, there's no way we're going to get to the whole album. We're not going to get to uncover all my favorite anecdotes. Well, as Michael mentioned, we got plenty of Brubeck programs that we're planning in the fall, for example. We're going to be exploring the fine-tooth comb, you might say, on an electron microscope. We're going to be looking at this amazing catalog of works and the man behind it. All right, let's keep going. You might ask if Blue Rondo has 9/8, as we said, subdivided 2 plus 2 plus 2 plus 3 times, plus 3 plus 3 plus 3, what else do we get on the album? So let's talk about the elephant in the room, the most iconic chart, not only on the album, not only perhaps one of the most signature tunes in jazz history, but also the most commercially successful one, and that's Take 5. Obviously, it's Take 5, right? So we're going to be in 5/4. Is there a historical antecedent for 5/4 in Western art music? And the answer is not really. I go to the piano. Had Mozart written in 5/4, it might have sounded something like this. Thank you. Or it might have sounded like this. Right? You get the idea. So, no, obviously Mozart doesn't sound like that because Mozart didn't write in 5/4, nor did he swing his eighth notes. He's an innovative guy, though, even without that. What about Beethoven? We said nothing in Beethoven. As you go further into the 19th century, you do start to see it here and there. It's fairly rare. I'm going to give you two examples where it comes up with the Russians. First, Modest Mussorgsky's Bilder aus einer Anstellung, pictures at an exhibition. I don't know, I gave you the German title. He's Russian, right? But that's how I know it, because that's when I had my score. It said Bilder aus einer Ausstellung, pictures at an exhibition. How does that piece start? Very, very iconic melody that it starts with. Probably most people are familiar with Maurice Ravel's orchestrated version, started as a piano suite nearly 50 years prior. But that tune well, count that. So we got 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, 1, and 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, 1, and 2, 3, 4, and 5, 1, and 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So what we call that maybe 5 plus 6, or let's call it 11. So that's an unusual example. Mussorgsky was trying to conjure something very, very specific there, which is the idea of sort of aimlessly ambling around in a museum gallery. So you're not marching in fixed periodicity, but rather sort of taking in the art the way that people take in art when they go to a museum gallery, which is you linger here, you speed up there, you pause there. So you get it there. And then, of course, the second movement, the so-called limping waltz in Tchaikovsky's Pathetique, the Sixth Symphony, the second movement, is in 5/4. But that's pretty rare for Western art music. Again, Handel, Bach, Mozart, Haydn, Schubert, Schumann, you name it, even in Wagner, as innovative as Wagner was, you just don't see fixed, you know, phrases in 5/4 time. So what you get in Take 5 is an exploration of 5/4 time, and again, this is where credit must be given to Joe Morello. You hear it when you listen to Joe Morello play, even on Blue Rondo, which we talked about. I should have mentioned, by the way, that the reason Dave called it Blue Rondo a la Turk is it's a reference to that Mozart sonata, this one. Right, that's the finale of Mozart's A major sonata, I think it's K331. The theme and variations, the one that starts here. Don't play it like that, by the way. That feels transgressive playing it like that. It's supposed to be slow and lyrical. But anyway, that's called the finale of that's called the Rondo alla Turca. So blue rondo combines the blues with the Rondo alla Turca. Anyway. So what's the genesis of Take Five? It starts with the vamp. The vamp, of course, very iconic. Anyone would recognize it. So we're counting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3. The chorus here, actually fairly straightforward. It's in a somewhat esoteric key of E flat minor, but it's only really a two chord vamp that forms the backbone of the piece, or at least as it was being written. So E flat minor. B flat minor 7, so a minor dominant, essentially, a minor 5-7. That was all they had to start. And initially, Joe Morello came up with, and we're going to listen to it in just about a minute, came up with a drum groove that is very different than the one we're used to hearing. So I'm very curious to see what people's reaction is going to be, because the drum groove he's going to play here, he's not swinging the eighth notes, and he's playing one and then on the and of three and downbeat of four. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So very different from that shuffling, sort of easy feeling, swung eighth note that we're so used to. So a very different prior incarnation of this. But even then, all they had was what we would call in jazz a vamp, a harmonic pattern that's sort of floating back and forth. What they needed was a good tune. Enter Paul Desmond. Now, this is the one track on the album that Paul Desmond wrote, and it's sort of, you know, you can't separate this tune from Paul Desmond, right? It's not just that he wrote it, but it's also the way it sounds. You hear these tunes where if you were transcribing it, you wonder, would you put a note value there? Or would you put an actual note or just an X head? He's like breathing into some of these notes, and it's such an iconic, I use the word ethereal sound. You'll hear that in a moment. Actually, I don't think you're going to hear it because I'm going to play. I've chosen a different version of Take Five, but maybe you will because we're going to listen to some of the studio session outtakes, if you will, from 1959. How many of us love listening to outtakes? Yeah. I think, you know, I was talking to Maestro Chris before the show, and he had a great line, which was, and I'm paraphrasing here, when you hear the quartet in their outtakes, you kind of breathe a sigh of relief because you're reminded that they were mortal. There's hope for the rest of us. We too are allowed to screw up, and it'll be okay. The sun's gonna come up tomorrow. Anyway, let's listen to some of those outtakes, and again, courtesy of the Brubeck Archive and Michael Bellicosa, who was able to provide me with these clips for this evening's program. I don't know if we can get the volume up. I hope it's audible from where it is. All right, now there's some, you can hear them talking. Anybody who's ever been in the studio, you probably are identifying with this right now. Anyone who's ever been part of a recording project is no doubt nodding in appreciation, perhaps even frowning in appreciation right now.
On the beginning, 1, 2, 3.
The dialogue's a little bit, okay. Do you hear how different the drum groove is? Almost sounds like Latin jazz, right? Do it again.
Take six.
I don't know. Is that Teo Macero? Is that him? Yeah.
Okay, Joe. This is okay. Give me one, so I'll be sure to come back.
Right. Skip. Skip ahead a little bit.
All right.
This is, by the way, recorded at 30th Street in Columbia, Columbia Records on 30th Street, same place where Miles had recorded in the spring. Of course, I'm going to pause it. For those who know take five, you know that one of the most salient features in the song is Joe Morello's solo. So you can hear Joe trying to sort of feel out how to improvise over this pattern. And it's interesting to consider that that drum solo is like hallowed ground for drummers. And for, I think, jazz fans, it's a widely studied solo. And yet you hear him here, he's kind of fishing for ideas, the way that musicians do. And it's wonderful to have a window into this workshop, to have a window into this very organic process. And the idea that even the greatest musicians that we think of as being sort of superhuman, they're fallible and they're coming up with different ideas here and seeing what sticks. I'm gonna play another.
This is a
okay, here's, I think this one. Okay, so here's the groove. Can you even hear it's in five? You'll see when he starts playing. Keep listening. All right, skip ahead a little bit. You hear the groove is da 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 da. Very, very different than, of course, what we're gonna become familiar with. Folks, you can't find this on YouTube. You can't get this on Netflix. You can't get this on Hulu or on Max. It's right here at the Brubeck Archive, the Wilton Library. It's pretty mind-blowing to think of this treasure trove that's right around the corner, literally. So cool. Anyway, we could listen to more of these outtakes, but I'm going to say that if you're interested in this sort of thing, spend some time here. Get the cans on, as we say. Put on your headphones and enjoy, because there's lots and lots. This is just a fragment. A scintilla, you might say, of what the archive has. I want to talk about some of the other songs on the album, and then we'll talk about the impact and legacy of Take Five. So what are some of the other, we're going to listen to, this is from 2007. This is an amazing recording. We'll listen to it in a moment. But before we continue with Take Five, let's just ask ourselves, well, okay, we've got 9/8 with the curious subdivisions we talked about that reflected the music that Dave heard on the streets of Istanbul. We've got this iconic exploration of 5/4, which, as we said, was a fairly non-existent time signature in Western art music. And that includes jazz, by the way. You know, what Dave Brubeck was doing here, this idea, this conception he had when he came back from Eurasia to write an album where the tunes are all sprinkled with various odd meters or explorations of odd meters, it's something that hadn't been done before. So the novelty of that can't be overstated. I should also point out that even though it's very novel and it's very progressive in that way, we see that it's tempered. What do I mean by that? Well, look at Blue Rondo. We said it's in that curious, that rhythm, which, again, Joe Morello's cymbal playing is like a clinic on how to keep time in an odd meter there. But then what do? They break into swing, right? So it's new, mixed with something familiar, something that it's like a person who's been thrown overboard. Okay, maybe you're not the best swimmer, but there's your life preserver. There's that swing section, you grab onto it, and you feel a sense of stability and familiarity. And that tends to be the case with many of the tracks on the album. For example, Three to Get Ready. I love what they do on that track. It's 3-4, 3-4, 4-4, 4-4, 3-4, 3-4, 4-4, 4-4. So it's like familiar, but also different. It's like two halves of something that's familiar, and together they make something that's odd and unusual, but ultimately there is something familiar there. Kathy's Waltz, I've got to, actually before we get here, I'll play a little bit of a transcription here of Paul Desmond's solo on Kathy's Waltz. So they're into three now. Just a little bit of Paul Desmond solo there. We're not going to listen to Paul Desmond on the 1959 album, so I thought maybe we would just hear a little bit and get to see a little bit of what's going on there. One other track that I'm not going to play, but I should mention, is Strange Meadowlark, which Dave wrote, I think, hearkening back to his days growing up in Northern California in the tranquility. You know, his father famously was Dave called him a cattleman, something like that, right? Not a rancher, but a cattleman. And he desperately wanted Dave to be a cattleman too. And so when it wasn't going to go in that direction, he said, all right, he can go to college like his brothers, but gosh darn it, he's going to study to be a veterinarian. And so Brubeck goes to college, and he's in like a biology class, and at the end, or maybe a zoology class, and at the end of the year, professor says to him, he says, Brubeck, go across the lawn to the conservatory and sign up already. Your head's not here. Anyway, so Strange Meadowlark starts in free time. In other words, you don't really feel a meter at all. So if you were going to extrapolate this idea of exploring odd meters, maybe one idea that you might eventually encounter is having music with no meter at all. And if you try to count, it's like trying to count Gregorian chant. You can't do it. I mean, you can do it, but it wouldn't make sense to the person next to you. One of the other things you get on Strange Meadowlark at the end is a really bold sort of dipping of the toes into polytonality, which is something that Dave had picked up during his studies with Mio. Polytonality, maybe it's worth a brief foray back to the piano, and then we'll listen to this recording from 2007. Polytonality is the presentation of music where different parts are in different keys at the same time. What might that sound like? You know, Igor Stravinsky had experimented with polytonality. For example, the Petrushka chord in the ballet Petrushka gives you first inversion F sharp major with C at the same time, C major. Hear that? Or in the Rite of Spring, where you get F flat major, that's E major for most of the world. Most of the world prefer to think of it that way, but F flat, and then E flat 7. Together, and you get. So this idea of polytonality was not new, but it hadn't been explored in jazz. And you get a little bit of it in Strange Meadowlark. Can you imagine, since we're talking about Mozart tonight, he's our litmus test for going back, what would Mozart sound like if it were polytonal? All right, my left hand's going to be in D flat, and my right hand's going to be in C. Should we reverse it? Let's put the right hand in D flat and the left hand in C. Which one did you like better? You liked both of them equally, didn't you? I knew it. All right, so that's a little bit about Strange Meadowlark. Let's go now to 2007, where Dave did a big recording session for the Milken Archive. And again, do the math. So 2007, he's born in 1920. So he's like 86, 87 years old at the time of this recording. And I want you to listen to how he plays the solo on take five. It's so different than how he plays it in 1959. And I think I prefer this one to the 1959 recording. That's going to be a matter of subjective taste. But what I would suggest here, and this is for me one of the things I love most about Dave Brubeck's improvisation, is his ability to create space. It doesn't have the frenetic buzzing quality of, say, Monk or Bud Powell. It's a different style. It's his own style. And he's able to create space. And also, you're going to hear him experiment with polytonality and polyrhythm here. So not experiment, but deploy, I guess you might say. So it's a totally different solo than the one from the 1959 album. And like my Mozart polytonal example, I want you to tell me which one you like better.
I know it's impossible with this one. You love them both just so much.
All right, here's Dave Brubeck in his late 80s. And listen to how imaginative and how whimsical this solo is. I have no way to bump the volume from here. Thank you, Michael. Working on the volume, by the way. Can you hear how outside the changes he is here? I don't know if you could hear what he was doing there. It, fairly abstract, but you can hear some of the polytonalities doing what we call playing outside. In other words, if the chord prescription is E flat minor and B flat minor 7 or whatever it is, you're choosing notes that don't maybe belong to that framework. And what it does, I think the effect for the listener is it just transports you to some other place where you're thinking of something, and it's your ear is kind of rooted in whatever the tonic is supposed to be, but the notes that you're hearing against it are so far away from it that the contrast between the two creates a product which I think is very, very not only imaginative and expressive, but it's thought-provoking as a listener. So I love the journey that he takes us on in this solo. It's so different than what he does in 1959. Question? Yeah, great question. How did the other musicians react when a soloist is playing outside the changes or outside the time signature or outside the rhythm? You have to have a really good rhythm section because it's very easy to get disorientated or get lost if you're, you know, if you're playing something and you're swinging dum chaka dum 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 dum, and you hear rhythms that just don't align. That if you tried to transcribe them, you'd need, you know, nested tuplets to do it because it just doesn't fit the framework. You need to have a really rock solid rhythm section. So, all right. I want to close the program time before we take questions. I've got two clips I prepared for you that are going to reflect just a little bit of the influence of this album on musicians who are maybe in the periphery of jazz, or, you know, they do something besides, you know, traditional jazz. So the first one, going back to Blue Rondo, is from Emerson, Lake, and Palmer. And here, of course, is Blue Rondo a la Turk, but instead of playing it in 9-8 with all those subdivisions we talked about, they played it in 4-4. And they were worried, apparently, Emerson was worried that Dave was not going to like it. He'd be offended somehow at this sort of this blasphemous, sacrilegious presentation of the tune because it's so warped, it's so different. And apparently, Dave sent him an autographed lead sheet, and it said something like, Keith, keep it the way it is, or something like that. The way your version is. I like your version, is what he was saying. All right, let's listen. They're doing here. Some of us might like it, some of us might love it, some of us might not like it so much. But irrespective, it just, I think, a testament or a reflection of how impactful this album was, that you had musicians from diverse genres playing in their own idiomatic way, trying to appropriate this material, take this material, transform it into something that would be familiar to their to fans of their style. It's idiosyncratic in an extreme way, and it's great. I want to talk about one more, and I'm going to walk over here. The late, great Latin jazz musician Tito Puente was also deeply influenced by Take Five, and he created a mambo version of it. So what that might that sound like? Well, like Emerson, Lake, and Palmer, they're going to take something in an odd meter and sort of, again, make it, put it into the idiosyncratic style that would be more at home for their listeners. So in this case, we take Five, and we put it in 4. And so you get something that sounds like this, in a mambo tempo. With a little montuno at the end, right? Very cool. But you can hear me play it
wouldn't it be better to hear Tito Puente do it? So let's go ahead and close our program with that.
What'd you think? Pretty cool, right? And all of this, and by the way, this is, we are scratching the surface. You can easily fall down the rabbit hole on YouTube. Look for various covers. You can find heavy metal covers with distorted guitar, but you know, people in someone's garage, or maybe in a professional recording studio, of all sort of musical genres and subgenres, and all of them can draw a dotted line, not even a dotted line, as a straight line back to 1959, back to Time Out, back to Dave Brubeck and this quartet, which recorded this incredible album, which remains so resonant, so expressive, so iconic, so recognizable for listeners, not just in the Western world, but I would suggest the world over. So I want to thank everybody for coming out tonight and enjoying this music with me, and I look forward to any questions you might have. And if I can't answer them, then maybe Chris Brubeck can.
Yeah, one thing that strikes me about listening to these complex rhythms is they seem very hard to dance to. I think one of the things that propelled jazz early in its history was that there was a dance craze in America. And in some historical sources, I've even seen jazz referred to as dance music. Was anybody still dancing to anything called jazz by the late 50s? Because it seems like that was something that made this type of experimentation possible.
Yeah, you're right. It would be difficult to dance to this kind of music, wouldn't it? I'm reminded, can I share one more anecdote? I'm reminded I was asked.
About a decade ago, my old college roommate asked me to play piano at his wedding. And I thought, yeah, sure, well, why not? And so I thought I'd have some fun at the rehearsal dinner. So, you know, you have to, they're marching out, right? And so whatever you're playing has to have some periodicity to it so that they can march out together. So I played this. I see my friend Claire is a cellist, and she's in the back there. I'm guessing you've played this bass line, I don't know how many times. Would it be more interesting if you played it in seven? Probably never thought, but you know, the bride and groom might not be so happy if they're trying to walk down to this. Can you imagine shuffling along to? But you know, again, like, where did I get that idea from? I draw a dotted line to Dave Brubeck because that I grew up. I was weaned on that album, and so that's maybe my first experience with odd time signatures goes back to when I was like 10 years old, and you know, I had my father bought the cassette. And puts it on, and I'm like, whoa, what's this? You know, I didn't know what it was. I didn't know what 5/4 was at the time. But as I learned more, oh wow, okay. So what if we apply this idea to something else? So is anyone moving to this music? I don't think so. I don't know of any. I've never come across anything in the literature that suggests that people were dancing to jazz the way they did, for example, in the 1930s. But if I'm wrong, someone, you know, I'd be happy to be corrected. I don't think so. I think this was, you know, nightclub music. You'd go out and you'd have your highball glass and you'd be enjoying it, and it was a cerebral experience. You know, jazz walks this very fine line where it's art music, right? You know, Duke Ellington famously called it American classical music. What did he mean by that? It means that to play jazz, to know jazz, you have to be trained. You can't just be some jaboni who learns, you know, G major, D major, E minor on a guitar and now start a band. See, my friend John Tu, he's an expert guitar player. He knows that you probably met many guitarists who fancy themselves musicians, but you can't play jazz if that's all you know. You need to be trained. You need to be inculcated in an ethos. And when we call jazz a kind of classical music, I think that's what we're getting at. This is intricate music that requires study, requires chops, if you will. You don't have to be a virtuoso, but you have to know what you're doing. I'm certainly no virtuoso, but I know my way around harmony. So I can get by, I can hack it in a jazz ensemble. I can also play Mozart in five, so you know. I guess, you know, to get back to it, right, jazz is in this weird in-between zone. It's art music, but like you mentioned, it was part of this youth craze in the 1920s and 30s where it was very much intertwined with the dance halls. I would suggest that change after World War II because you have this great migration out to the suburbs, and all those young people who are dancing are now getting married and having families, and they've got televisions and TV dinners. And you know, I'm kind of hyperbolizing a little bit, but I think that to some degree was it marked the end or coincided with the end of the sort of the jazz as dance era. Chris. Yeah. Yeah. So there are examples, but I think by 1959, you know, you read about them going to nightclubs and people kind of sitting at tables. That's what you read about. You don't read about people dancing at, you know, at the clubs that these guys were playing at. Any other questions? Well, Michael?
Okay, Gil, thank you very much. That was fantastic.
All right. Thank you all. And I hope to see you in May and June. Get home safe, everybody. Thank you.